Hi viewers, welcome to our Electrical Engineering lecture channel for most interactive sessions of different subjects of Electronic and Electrical Engineering. For the latest updates and videos, don't forget to subscribe and click the like button.
That will fill this gap to make it periodic with period 2 pi. And to have that, we will have the second term of that above equation, x of e raised to power j omega minus 2 pi divided by 2. So it means that now, having this particular DTFT in hand, to plot this expression, we need two things. First of all, we need to displace, or we need to time frequency shift the DTFT by an amount 2 pi and then scale. That we have to do, but as a sequence that we usually follow, that we first of all we scale the signal and then we perform the time shifting, frequency shifting. So we will use this particular scaled version, and just if we shift it by an amount 2 pi, and we will get the second term. So if we shift it by an amount 2 pi, you see this, if let us have 2 pi over here, then this copy will come over here. After shifting, it will become like this, and this copy, which is located at minus 4 pi, it will come at minus 2 pi, like this, and so on. Now this was the first term, and this was the second term of equation 1. Now if you add both of them point by point, and apply this scaling factor of 1 by 2, you will see that if we add both these plots point by point, then these gaps, these two gaps, and consequently the other gaps will be filled by this one. And overall, the plot will look like this. Now I am plotting the resultant of these two. And let us call it xd of j omega. It will become this one, from minus pi to pi. If here is 2 pi, then we will have this one. If here is minus 2 pi, and here is this one. So see, these two copies from here, and the central copy from here. So this is the decimated version, and the DTFT of the decimated signal, and the amplitude will be 1 over 2 times t, because 1 over t was actually there. Here it was 1 over t. Here it was 1 over t. Similarly, here is 1 over t. And due to the scaling factor of 1 by 2 in the equation, we will have got 1 over 2t here. So that is the resultant DTFT. Now, the problem is that this was the case of m is equal to 2. When we will have m is equal to 3, m is equal to 4, and so on, we need to have multiple terms of this particular equation. For m is equal to 2, we have got two terms, we have got two plots, and then we added them up to get the resultant. But if we will have m is equal to 3, then we will have three plots, and then after adding those three plots, we will get the resultant. So this method cannot be adopted. We need to draw many plots. So as a shorthand method to plot the resultant directly, the rule of thumb is very simple. If you look at this plot and the original plot, do you find any similarity or any rule of thumb as a general rule? So that general rule is, you simply scale the actual DTFT by the decimation factor, and you will not move the copies which are located at integral multiples of 2 pi. Let me repeat. You will only scale the original DTFT given over here by the decimation factor, and you will not move the copies located at the integral multiples of 2 pi. So if you see, I just scale it in the same plot. If I scale this copy by a factor of 2, I will get this one, and I will not move this copy as a general rule. Just being there, I will simply scale it. Similarly, I will not move this one. I will simply scale it. So you see, and just you place a 2 over here. 1 over it will become 1 over 2t. So you see, now this red dotted plot and this resultant plot are exactly the same. So you do not need to do this practice every time or do this method every time. You can directly plot the DTFT of the decimated signal in this way, which is a general rule. And we have taken the example of 2. So it definitely it can be extended for any value of m. The only condition is that m must be an integer. So now let us see the same concept and on this slide also. It is almost the same example that we have discussed just now, with only difference that here we have also plotted the CTFT of the decimated signal. And you can always see that there is a very strong relationship, which is small omega is equal to capital omega into t prime. So if I am going to go into this axis, I will divide the small omega axis by t prime. So that is the only thing that we have done here. You see, we have divided this axis by capital T to result in capital omega. And you can see the change in the x-axis directly. Now, one of the most important concerns in decimation is the verification of Nyquist criteria, that the main point is we are going to reduce the sampling frequency. And Nyquist criteria states that the sampling frequency must be at least greater than 2 times the maximum frequency of the continuous time signal. So whenever we reduce the sampling frequency, it may happen that we reduce it to such extent that Nyquist criteria is no more met. Then aliasing will occur. So due to this reason, this is a very important concern. While reducing the sampling rate, we need to keep in mind the Nyquist criteria. So we can have 2 options to avoid aliasing in case of decimation. The first condition, these 2 are OR conditions basically. The first condition is the sampling rate can be reduced by a factor m without aliasing if the original sampling rate was at least m times the Nyquist rate, right? So for example, if the maximum frequency of a continuous time signal was 1 kilohertz, and we have, as per Nyquist criteria, we need to select at least 2 kilohertz sampling frequency. But for example, we took 8 kilohertz. So now it is 4 times greater than the Nyquist criteria. It means there is a leverage that we can perform 4 times decimation to avoid aliasing. So if we have a requisite sampling rate beforehand as per Nyquist criteria, then we can perform decimation to a particular extent without having aliasing. But if this it doesn't happen, and we have the exact sampling rate exact equal to Nyquist rate, then what will happen? We will have the second condition. If the bandwidth of the sequence is first reduced by a factor of m by discrete time filtering, we need to reduce the bandwidth, because if sampling rate is exactly equal to Nyquist rate, we cannot perform decimation without aliasing. So we need to reduce the bandwidth of the sampling rate. In that case, we will actually ourselves trying to reduce the aliasing and trying to create that leverage that was not actually there. To have this concept, and you can also write it mathematically like this, that omega n capital M will be less than or equal to pi, or omega n less than pi by m. This is the reduced bandwidth. That if the bandwidth of the signal in the DTFT, it is less than pi over m, then we can perform decimation by a factor of m without aliasing. We can just continue the same example, which we are already discussing. Let me draw again it. Let's say we have x of e raised to power j omega as this signal, which is minus pi by 2 to pi by 2. Here is pi, here is 2 pi, and this is minus 2 pi. With the amplitude of 1 over t. Now if we perform decimation by a factor of 3, what will happen? Let us draw it. By a factor of 3 means I need to, what was the general rule? That was that I will scale the actual DTFT by the decimation factor. So that pi by 2 point will go to 3 pi by 2. If let's say 3 by 2 was over here, then it will be like this. The amplitude will be decreased. You will have this one, and the copy which is located at 2 pi, it will also be scaled, because as per general rule, we will not move these copies. So this copy will also be scaled, and it will be scaled in a fashion that it will interfere with the original copy. Similarly, this one will also interfere. If this is minus pi, and like this, and the amplitude is 1 over mt, which is, in our case, it is equal to 1 over 3t. Now you see there is aliasing, because the copies are intermixing each other, and the content which is corrupted is this one. If I just plot that range, this is the frequency range which is causing trouble. So this is called aliasing, that the spectral content or the frequency content of the signal is distorted. To avoid this, the second rule, now here you see the rule was not met. The first condition was not met. So we will move to the second condition, and which states that the we will reduce the bandwidth of the original signal to make it less than pi by m. So here we will pass through this particular signal through a low pass filter. Let's say call it as h e raised to power j omega. And that low pass filter is such that its bandwidth is pi by 3. Where 3 is the decimation factor. And as you should know, that the same filter will have copies at integral multiples of 2 pi because of periodicity. Now, if you pass the actual signal through this discrete time filter, then the end result will be what? End result will be like this. You will have, after filtering, you will have things like this, pi by 3 minus pi by 3. And here the same concept at 2 pi, and the same concept at minus 2 pi. Now if you scale, now if you perform decimation with a factor of 3, now as per general rule, again, what will happen? Let me call it at x filtered e raised to power j omega. And now if you perform decimation to this filtered signal, xd of e raised to power j omega, so what will happen? If here is minus pi, so it will be scaled by a factor of 3. This copy will also be scaled. And this copy will also be scaled. Like this. The amplitude of 1 over 3t. So you see what happened here. We intentionally destroyed, or we intentionally discarded, some frequency content of the original signal through low pass filtering to avoid aliasing. Now the question arises that we have also changed the spectral content of the signal intentionally, but you see the content we have changed is less than the content that aliasing was changing. To see this, you can see that if I pass the actual signal through this low pass filter, I am losing this much spectral content. But here, you see, the spectral content destroyed by aliasing is much more than the content of the content that we intentionally discarded through low pass filtering. So that will be the procedure. And due to this reason, decimation is usually involves the low pass filtering always. It is called pre-filtering. And this filtering will be digital filtering. So whenever you talk about decimation, it will always contain the filter first and then perform the decimation. And so as a convention, when we usually say downsampling, it means we are only talking about discarding samples. But when we talk about decimation, it will contain both the things, filtering and downsampling. So you see, just discarding the sample is called downsampling, and filtering plus downsampling will be called decimation. To conclude this, let's come over here. The same concept I have already explained, the filtering concept and all that stuff we have already discussed. So now this is the general system for downsampling. You see, if we have the discrete time signal x of n as the input which has been sampled at a sampling period capital T, it will be passed through a low pass filter having gain is equal to 1 and cutoff frequency of pi over m, right? So this filter is sort of mandatory for decimation. And then after filtering, we will get x tilde of n having some content discarded through low pass filtering. The sampling period will be the same. One important point is that the input and output of the low pass filter will be at the same sampling rate. Sampling rate change will be over here. So now the filtered signal will be passed through this downsampling stage by a factor of m to result in this particular signal, which is having a sampling period capital T prime, which is equal to capital M into capital T. So that is the concept of downsampling. Thank you very much.